Okay, we're going to start with the average function, and we're going to want to get the average of the order amount. And since I took my mouse and I already selected the amounts that we want to average, I can cheat a little bit. I go in the lower right hand corner and I select this, and it will tell me that the average is about $340. So we're going to know for right if we come up with that number. So if we type in the function, you can do it lowercase or uppercase, it doesn't matter. And once you type the beginning parentheses, this box of instructions comes up, and the highlight is on the section that I'm on right now. So since I put in the starting parentheses, there's a little gray line underneath, and it says that that's waiting for input. And the input that it's waiting for is what's highlighted here. So it wants the first value, and the value is going to be the range of F3. And then you do a colon to F8. And now you see that little gray line is not here anymore. So you can be done with the values. It doesn't need anything to complete the function. And it's already telling you in the blue font what the answer is going to be if you end it right now. So I'm going to put in a closing parentheses. I'm going to type enter. And there it is, $339. That's what we saw in the lower right hand corner, so we know that's probably right. The next three functions that you're going to use all the time are sum functions. There's different types of sum functions, and we're going to use them all on the amount column. The first one is just a straight up regular sum function. It's already in here. I'll double click on it. It's just sum, and then it takes the range. So that is just going to add up all the orders no matter what, and it comes up to $2,037. But you can also sum them according to criteria that you set. So you can say sum these if, sum if, then you select the range with the criteria in it. So I'm not summing the sales rep range. I'm using this range to decide whether or not I want to sum this range. So this function goes one row at a time, and it looks to see if column C has the word Rex in it. And if so, it's going to add the corresponding value in column F for row 3. So it'll add 261.96. It'll skip these. It'll come down and pick up 48.86. And then you'll be done. So if I hit enter, that's how it comes up with 310.82. And the next one is called sum ifs. And that's just a compound sum if statement. So it's saying sum these if a couple things are happening. In this case, it's saying sum it if the sales rep is Rex and Rex sold those items in Henderson. That happens to only be this first line because the other Rex was sold in Emsworth, Pennsylvania. So that should just sum up to 261.96. Three different types of sum formulas, and they can get you completely different answers. Okay, we've gone through average and we've gone through sum. Another one that you'll probably use a lot is the count function. So we're going to use it on the extra column because it can act differently when there's text. And just with a straight count function, all it does is it counts the occurrences of numbers. If I look in the helper text here, it returns the count of the number of numeric values in a data set. There's only one here, 22. Use count A, it will count all of the values in here. The only thing it won't count is blanks. Right now it's getting 4, which looks like what it should be getting. But you have to be careful with the count A, because if I go in cell K5 and I hit the space key, which is a way of putting some information in here, but you can't actually see it, you'll see the count goes from 4 to 5. Maybe that's still what you wanted, right? Because that is data in there. It's just a space and you can't see it. But be careful. If you're using count A and you're getting a value that you don't expect, you may have to go about this differently. And then count if can be used in any way you want. In this case, we're saying, look, count it if it has the letters VIP in it. That's your criteria. That happens up here twice. And so it's 2. Now again, if I put a space before the VIP, it's not going to count. So it only found one of them if there's a space. Now you can get into the trim function if you need to clean up your data, but that didn't make the top 10. The next functions are today and now, and these can be used to figure out the amount of time that's elapsed. They're very similar functions, but one of them has a little bit extra compared to the others. So if you do today, that takes just the value of the day today. And this works a little bit differently in that it takes nothing in the parentheses, but it still needs them because all functions need parentheses. So just close this one off. That's today. And then if you subtract the time at which this sale was made, you can tell it was done 258 days ago. The now function, like I said, works very similar to it, and it's going to return the day and the time. It's early in the morning right now. So if I want to find the exact amount of time that has elapsed from these orders, I can do now, and then I can subtract one of these dates. And so add them together, one of the times, and do the subtraction. So it was almost 258 days ago that sale was made. And you can tell the times come out just as fractions of a day in Google Sheets. So if one of these dates was noon, it'd be a half. And then the last function that you'll probably find yourself using a lot is concatenate. And concatenate joins values together. So we could go through this table and we can join these, make it look like an address. And how you would do that, you would just start out with the equal sign and then you type concatenate. Sheets is guessing what I'm going to type here. I'll select the second one, left click on it. It says, hey, give me the first thing to concatenate. So I'll give it Henderson. Then I'm going to want a comma and a space. So add those as the exact value. Just type it in as a string. Make sure you put quotes around it. That's what tells Sheets that you're typing in a string and not a number. Then you want the value of Arizona and I3. I'm grabbing those just by left clicking with my mouse. Another way to get them, hold on, let me put a space in here, is again, you see the little gray bar at the bottom that shows it's waiting for input. Take your arrow key and just start moving the cell selector around and go over to the postal code. And you see it's filled in J3 and the blue text is telling you what it's going to look like if you just hit enter now. And that's right. So just close it off with the parentheses, type enter, and that's concatenate. So if you want to do that for the line below it, just like any function, after you enter it, you have a blue rectangle. And in the lower right-hand corner of the blue rectangle, you have a little square. Hover over that till your mouse becomes a plus. Hold down your left mouse key and just drag it down. I'll go further so you'll see it stops working. But these are relative cell references. So the next one picked up this line. One after that picked up the third line. So that should do it. That covers the top 10 functions that you're going to use working with spreadsheets. And almost all the time, these are going to be all that you need to get done what you need to get done. If they're not what you need, you can find all the others. If you go up to Insert and select Function, this is some of the more common ones. We didn't even hit on Max and Min. You do more. This is going to list all the functions, so you can look them all up here to find what you want. So I hope that was helpful. If you liked that video and you want to see others just like it, please subscribe in the lower right-hand corner. Thanks.